Hello, everyone. So I guess I should start already. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining this session. So please make me sign on the chat if you can see my slides full screen. I will play it just for a second. The problem is that as soon as I put it full screen, I get the window lost and I cannot see what you write. So please tell me right now is normally in full screen. So I will give only 3 seconds and you let me know if you can see it in full screen. So perfect. So now I stop the full screen. Yes, perfect. So thank you very much, Javier. So yes, this is a bit problematic because I cannot see the chat while I'm speaking. So please just write your questions, and as soon as I finish with the presentation, I can go through the chat. We have also some members of the Apache Guayan, who is Bertie Contreras, is already here. So he can also answer the questions as you are having it. Okay, so, okay, perfect. Let me start with this. So first of all, I excuse myself because my voice is a bit breaking. I got flu and I'm just recovering, but I hope you can hear me correctly. So yes, this presentation is about how we can bring big data to the IoT environments, basically how to deal with big with IoT data, with big data systems such as Spark, Flink, and so on. So my name is Jorge, and I'm at TU Berlin. I'm principal researcher. So yes, let me start. To start, let me give you the landscape of big data in 2012. So basically, that was how it was looking like. Of course, there were more systems than this, but the most representative are here. And especially in the bottom technologies, you can see that, in fact, pretty much everything was based on the Hadoop environment, right? That's basically more or less what we had back in 2012. And this is for one reason, because back in 2020, and in that decade, so we had very simple queries like select, project, and join queries that are quite suitable for SQL systems, I mean, database management systems. And that is why we didn't have a lot of diversity of the systems until Hadoop arrived and basically make this elephant a bit more scalable for other kind of workloads that was batch processing, in fact. But when we look at data analytics today, we'll realize that now the world is quite different of what we had 10 years ago. Now we have workloads that goes not only from relational, but from graph processing to machine learning and deep learning. Plus, there are a lot of streaming data coming, right? IoT is one of these streaming data sources. So now this big elephant, the database management systems, they are not enough to deal with all these kind of workloads. It doesn't fit all, right? So most of you, I'm sure that you already heard that one system doesn't fit all or one size doesn't fit all. And because of this, now the landscape, it looks like something like this. So if you see, don't try to understand, of course, the images of the systems. The point is that is order of magnitude more systems than what we had 10 years ago. So this is basically bring us to the point that from a single elephant, now today we finish with a zoo of systems where you have diverse animals there that can deal with different workloads in a very specific way, right? So now the question that the developers has or that they have is, what is the right system to use for my workload at hand? So that's basically the main problem that we have today. And in many cases, we end up choosing one system that can be very good in some workloads, but not that great for other workloads. And then we need to migrate our systems to a more performant system and so on and so forth. I'm sure that you already have experienced these kind of problems. So the question is, so which system to take? We believe that instead of generating yet another animal, what we need to do is to tame all these animals, all these systems, to work together, to communicate among them. That's what we need to do. And this is what basically we call the cross-platform data processing. That is the use of multiple data processing platforms for query processing. And it can be running one query in one shot, for example, for a particular data set in one system, and then for another data set in another system, but can be also one query running at the same time on multiple systems. We will see that later on. And basically, Apache Wayang, that is what it is. It's a cross-platform processing, data processing system that try to orchestrate the execution of a single task over multiple data platforms, data processing platforms. And in this talk, what we want to see is how we can use this big data technology and Apache, via Apache Wayang, to deal with IoT data. For this, we will use the following running example that comes from a real customer in one of the companies that is InfiniMesh, that is contributing also into Apache Wayang. So they have solar panels, and they want to understand what is going to be the energy production for the next 10 minutes. And this, of course, will vary, depends on the climate at that point on time. So they are getting data from solar panels and from climate sensors, and they need to figure out what is going to be the production in the next 10, 20 minutes. That's basically what we will do. and to understand how Wayang can help here, let us first understand what Wayang is to better understand. So we will see a bit of history of Wayang, and then we will explain what exactly is cross-platform data processing and how Wayang can make it happen via an optimizer that decides for you what is the right system for your particular workload at hand. And then once we understand that, we will discuss how Wayang can be used to deal with IoT data. And finally, we will just quickly present some words about the community of Apache Wayang. So let us start by history. So Wayang started in 2015 as a research project in the Qatar Computing Research Institute, mainly that is located in Doha, is the capital of Qatar, and it was called RIM. And here, what we had back then, we already have seen all this problem. When we were doing our research, we had to figure out what is the right system for a particular plate. And then we said, why we have to do this and not to create some kind of a system that gives us independence of the underlying big data platforms. That is how RIM started. Then in 2019, in October, to be precise, I moved from Qatar and also other core people of the team. We moved to Berlin, TU Berlin specifically. And that is where TU Berlin got involved as well. And Bifold, that is AI institution here in Berlin that is being created, they start getting involved into this project. And also a company that was created out of the RIM project that is called Escalytics. And thanks to all this support, we could get into the Apache community. So we are now in the incubation process since the mid-December 2020. And we will have, as we will see, our one of our first release inside the Apache community in the next couple of days. That is basically how Wayang is starting. So if you are interested to see what is the research footprint, I invite you to go to the Wayang website in the publications tab. And there you will see all the research behind Apache Wayang. And mainly you will see how Wayang evolved, how what was the main topics of interest when we were developing Wayang. So please, I invite you to take a look. And in case you are interested in any of this research, just drop an email to our dev list. So then the question would be, why Wayang? We pick the name of Wayang because Wayang is a traditional theater for form, form of puppet theater, basically. So this comes from Java, that is an island of Indonesia. And basically, why we took this, because it's an analogy to what we are doing with the big data systems today. So basically, we are trying to leverage what we exist today, and we try to make them work on just on some parts of the entire task or problem that you have, and we coordinate all these for the on the user's behalf, and with the main goal of improving performance or even monetary cost in case you are running your systems on the cloud. That is why we pick the name of Wayang. Now, the main goal, it was to provide independence between the applications and the big data platforms, so that every time it was a new system appearing that was better for a particular workload, you don't have to change your application. So that is, so you can see Wayang like a kind of like a middleware between applications and all these big data platforms. It was the main goal when we created Wayang. But soon we realized that we could do way more than giving independence. And here is the side effect benefit of this, that is the cross-platform data processing. So on the left side, you will see a Wayang plan. The operators are quite similar to what is Flink and Apache Spark. And what we try to do is for every single operator, we try to decide what is the right platform. For example, here, orange is a Spark and green is a Java standalone program that we developed to perform also data flow jobs. And you may wonder why Java, a standalone program. We will see the benefits of doing this with some examples. But if you see, we can decide for every single operator where to run it. So that means open up a new spectrum of applications that were kind of not possible today or before in an automatic manner. So that is basically what Apache Wayang is providing. And to understand this spectrum, we will go to see what is the different use cases of Wayang, and more precisely for the cross-platform data processing. Perfect. So just 1 second, I will drink a bit of water. Sorry. Okay. So the first case is what we call platform independence. So let's illustrate this by the following example. Think about you have the word count, right? Now the word count, as you may know, is like the hello world of the big data, right? So it's one of the most simple and basic applications that we use as a running example when we want to illustrate the capabilities of a big data system, right? So now think about you have a small file where you need to run this application. And a small file, I'm talking about 300 megabytes, for example. If you have to develop word count, in many cases, developers, they won't think about using Spark, right? Because Spark is for big data. So for 200 or 300 megabytes, why I will pass through all this learning curve if I didn't know Spark to learn how Spark works so that I can implement my job? So in that case, I will just do it on a Java program, right? So that is basically what you would do. So Wayang allows you to code it only in the API of Wayang, and Wayang will decide where to run that job. If it's a small data, we'll automatically decide to go to Spark. And let me show you the code snippet of Wayang. Here you have this code snippet of word count. And if you see in the very first lines, we specify what is the plugin. If you see, it's in the 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5 line, if you start by object, that is dot with plugin. And we say it's going to be Java, meaning only by saying that, we know that our program will run on the Java system or engine that we developed. And then below, you will see the plan builder, the Wayang plan. And it's going to look pretty similar to Apache Flink, Apache Spark. And we did it on purpose. We wanted to keep the same kind of interface as these systems that are widely used today. So you will see there the flat map, a filter, the map, the group by, and so on and so forth. So that is how it looks like. What is important here is that in this line of code, you don't see anything with respect to Java or Spark or whatsoever. We just define this by giving the right plugin. In that case, it's Java, and will run on Java. Now, what happened if now you have a terabyte of data, right? Now, clearly, Java is not the solution. It will last a day or more than a day to run this, right? So in that case, the beauty of Wayang that you have nothing to do, it will decide automatically to run that on Spark. But if you want to force Wayang to do it, basically you need to change this line of code. From Java, you will put Spark, and then Wayang will go to Spark, right? And similarly now, think about, you don't have word count, you have a join query. And in that case, we know that the best for join queries is a database management system. Let's assume in this case, Postgres. So in that case, you will do the same stuff. You will add a line where you will add the plugin of Postgres, and magic is done. So that's everything you need to do. And the code of word count or join doesn't change at all. That's basically what Wayang provides to you. And that's the platform independence. Now let's see. We did a small example with the word count using the Wikipedia data, where we run it using our Java engine, Spark, and Flink. And we did it varying the different the data set size, of course. And for doing this, and to let Wayang to pick the right platform, basically now we declare three different platforms, Java, Spark, and Flink. By doing this, we are basically telling Wayang, hey, you know what? I don't know what to do. This is the platforms I have. Pick the best for this particular job. And Wayang will pick the best. And now let's see. Here the x-axis is the dataset size. And the Wikipedia is roughly 2.5 gigabytes, if I'm not wrong. And we increase this to see. We start with a very small to make Java engine a competitor. Otherwise, Spark or Flink was going to be always the best. And then we increase it to make Java slower and so on. And here the asterisk or the star we see is the choice picked by Wayang. And we can see that Wayang selects the best platform in all cases. And this is where the developer, it gets free from all this boarding. So the developer just code word count, declare the three platforms, and he knows he will get the best performance as possible. We can see it started with Java in the number one, and then we'll move to Flink, which is indeed the fastest, continue with Flink, and so on, until Spark becomes the fastest and switch to Spark. So this is what basically Wayang allows you to do. Now, let's see another case of cross-platform data processing, and that is polystores. Most likely, some of you, or many of you, have already heard about it. Polystores, as the name says, means you have different storage engines where the data that you want to process is stored. So think about, you have a relation about customers, a relation about orders, and the transactional line item relation. That comes from a very well-known benchmark in databases, that is TPCH, basically. And assume that customers and orders are on Postgres. And this is realistic because these relations are pretty small compared to line item. Line item represents close to 80% of the entire data compared to the others, right? So that one, you want to store it, for example, on HDFS. So when you have this, now the question is, how do you run this? There are different ways of doing that. There are common practices of moving the data from one place to another. Now Spark comes with different connectors that can get the data from Postgres and so on and so forth, right? So what Wayang will do, it will basically via its cost model, identify which operators to push down to Postgres. And in this case, for example, is gonna be the selection or the first join where the customers and others is, and then bring the join result that will represent as a GR1 into Spark, and then perform the second join that you see here in the plan on Spark, right? And all this is completely transparent from the developer or the user. And let's see what is the benefit. So we took the query 5, that is a common query in the benchmark TPCH, where you have also three joints, if I'm not mistaken, and you have basically five different relations, or six different relations, sorry. And then we pick Wayang and we compare this with two common cases. Common case is all the data is I move it to Postgres, or all the data I move it to Spark, right? And what we get here, first in the x-axis, we vary the size of the data sets. And this is the scale factor, where scale factor one is 1 gigabyte. Then we have 10 gigabytes and 100 gigabytes. And we see that the systems, they perform differently, right? But I mean, Postgres and Spark. But if you see Wayang perform basically better than all this, and in the worst case, quite similar to the ideal case, where the ideal case is move all the data to HDFS and run Spark in that case, that we see it here for 100 gigabytes. And we need to notice that also Wayang here got a slowdown, because the current connector, when we, or the connector we had by then, when we run the experiment, it was based on basically JDBC. And this was pretty slow. We saw that it was a bottleneck. Currently, we are working on a better adapter to make this faster. And we expect Wayang to become faster than Spark, even in those cases when you have large data set. But once more again, the beauty here in the Polystore when using Wayang is that you as a developer, you don't have to worry. You let Wayang to do the job, and he will decide how to move data from one system to another. So now let's go to the third case, that we call it the opportunistic cross-platform. This is something that we face today without noticing it. In many cases, you have data on a single storage. It's not polystore anymore. It's monostore. Like, for example, you have it on HDFS. Automatically, when you have, let's say, 1 terabyte of data, people will say, let's use a Spark or Flink, and that's it, right? That is one of the common mistakes that I would say that we do, because we don't spot huge opportunities we have. For example, if you want to run a machine learning algorithm by modeling this, but an optimization problem, and then you use the stochastic gradient design algorithm to solve that problem. So the pipeline that you will have is something as you see here on the right of the application. So you will parse the input, prepare it, and then you will sample the data, because this algorithm works with only one data point at once, right? And then they iterate, and for every iteration, sample a different data point. So that is the way SGD works. And here, if you realize the compute, where we compute the gradient of the new data point and update the vector, the W vector that represents your model, it works only in one data point. So why to work on a Spark for these particular operators, right? So that is basically what Wayang will do. It will do the sample on a Spark because it's over large data. But once do the sample, we'll move this data point into the Java engine, and we'll do the compute and the update there, and we'll iterate again back, and we'll come back to Spark. And you may say, okay, but doing all this back and forth, moving the data to Java, from Java to Spark, and vice versa, it will have a lot of overhead. Let us see this kind of possible overhead. Here we run the same task, SGD, for different data sets. And basically, we compare it against MLib and SystemML that today evolved to SystemDS, if I'm not wrong. And we compare it for these three different data sets. And we see here that Apache Wayang can be up to more than one order of magnitude faster just by moving this single data point into the Java engine. And why? Because you don't have all this overhead of the Mastodon that is Apache Spark, that was developed with big data in mind. And of course, they did a great job to have the latency lower compared to Hadoop. That Hadoop before, it was no job could be performed before less than 22 seconds or 25 seconds, right? A Spark can be in a second or so. And now they prove also that they can go to the milliseconds side. Yet, still, by using a native a standalone program, it will bring you less overhead. And this, as a developer, is super hard to spot it. It's, or I would say, almost impossible to spot that you will get order of magnitude better performance by doing so. And here, Wayang is where it helps the developers to do that. It frees you from all this. So, yes, that is the third case. And the fourth case of cross-platform where Wayang can be used is what we call the mandatory. So what does it mean this? Think about you have some page rank over multiple communities, the German community and the English community. You want to intersect this and perform some page rank task, right? So you are joining and doing the page rank afterwards. So, and think about that the data is on Postgres. So if you want to do this in Postgres, although it will be possible by doing some driver and doing the iterations, it's going to be a nightmare. And in terms of performance, it will just kill performance, right? So what you would do in most of the cases, move the data out and put it either on Spark, on a graph processing system, and perform it there. What we say is, no, don't move the data by yourself. Let another system, in this case, Wayang, to do the job for you. So Wayang will push down, in this case, the projection of the data in Postgres, will get only the relevant data, move it to Spark, perform the iterations there, and give you back the results. And it's mandatory. We call it mandatory because Postgres is not the right platform or doesn't have the capability for do iterations, right? For performing iterations. That is the second case of mandatory. And we also have, if you go to our publications in the webpage, you will see the benefits of doing this. Compare it to ideal cases or the current practices. So basically, that is the four different use cases. Now you may wonder, okay, I know that you free all this from the developers. So how Wayang managed to do this? If you go to our code, what exactly, I mean, in the Wayang repository, what exactly you will find out there? What is the different components, or at least the core components? So that is that Wayang comes with a cost-based optimizer. And let us go into this first slide that I present and go inside the Wayang box. So the first thing when you have a Wayang plan is do the inflation of these plans. What does it mean, the inflation? Let me explain it as follows. Think about that you have two platforms, that is Spark and Java, where orange is for Spark and Java is in green. So what we do is that for every single operator, let's say hero one, we figure out what is the alternative or what is the possible execution we can do in one of the existing systems. And we inflate the operator. That means this single operator, we give all the options where this operator can be executed. In this case, Spark and Java. But if Spark didn't exist, in that case, this orange circle wouldn't appear. It would be only Java, right? So basically, Wayang just say, for these three operators in the Wayang plan, which are my options? And I put it here. And this is done via what we call mappings. And these mappings is like a graph transformations. You can map from one to one operator, or you can map from one to several operators, or from one Wayang operator to a constellation of other operators. Like, for example, you can have a Wayang operator that is called clustering, but that maps to a constellation of Wayang operators that contains map, intersections, and so on. So, and this, the user doesn't have to deal with all this. So once we do the inflation, then we say, okay, now we know where we could execute every single operator. Now, how we pick the right option? And this is using a cost model. So we say, for every operator, what is the cost of running that on Spark? And what is the cost of running that on Flink, Java, etc.? We put for every single option, we give a label, right? And then we do some kind of enumeration that in this case, we do brute force enumeration, but we have a very effective pruning technique that allows us to significantly reduce the search space and not go into the problem of just being exploring this search space. Because remember, this is an empty heart problem. So we prune it and we just label those resulting possible operators. Once we tag this and we say, okay, look, it's cheaper to do it on Spark than on Java. So let's do it on Java, on Spark, sorry. However, it's possible that for a future operation, you need to move data to Java. So you need to take into account also what is the cost of this data movement, right? And to say, hey, you know what? Even if Java is more expensive here, it's better to pick Java because overall, it's going to be cheaper. Like this, I don't move data. And this is basically the other component that is the data movement cost that Wayang will do. So once do all this, then Wayang will have all the elements to pick the right execution plan and does all this while enumerating plans. So here, for illustration purposes, we show this as a pipeline. But if you go to our code, you will see that doesn't exist such a pipeline. It exists only the plan enumeration, the plan inflation, sorry, and then the plan enumeration. And while enumerating the plans, we label everything with the cost, the data movement cost, and it's there that we start expanding our plans. And that is why we don't end up with an exponential search space of multiple options, because we prune early on in the plan enumeration. Then you have a resulting plan that we call execution plan. And in this case, just for illustrating purposes, decides to run the first operator on Spark, the second on Java, and the third on Java. And of course, in between, Wayang will insert what we call conversion operators. And these operators will move the data from one platform to another and put it on the right format. So for example, now it's Java, but if it was a graph system, it will transform that into a graph so that the graph system, like a GraphQL or Giraffe, can process that data. That is basically what Wayang will do. And all this is customizable. So you as a developer, if you see that we have a conversion operator or data movement operator that is suboptimal, you can provide one that it suits you the best for your workload. And you don't have to change anything in the core of Wayang. So basically, you provide this as a new operator, and you say to Wayang, using mappings and so on, that it can use now this new operator when doing the optimization. So now, once we understood these possible ways of running Wayang, the question is, how we can exploit Wayang to process IoT data, right? Because if you realize, Wayang was developed mainly for big data. So how it comes that we can do IoT data? And now that's what I will explain. Sorry for that. Okay, so let's go back to our running example. That is the solar energy production prediction. Remember that this user wants to know what is going to be the energy production in the near future. You have data coming from solar panels and data coming from climate sensors to know how much sun the solar panels will get, what is humidity, temperature, etc., etc. Right? Now, if we go to IoT, we will see that we have this three-layer architecture, right? And you will say, okay, now, the three-layer architecture, mainly the three main phases, that is the edge, the fog, and the cloud. So how Wayang will do this? So first of all, you as a developer, the only thing when coding in Wayang, you don't have to worry about it. You will code only the main functionality of your application. In this case, getting the relevant data from solar panels and climate sensors. This is going to be the filter operator. Then you want to join these two data and group by to create by, for example, range period of time to create some time series so that you can train a model and do the prediction for the next 10 minutes, for example. This is what you need to worry in Wayang. Just code your application. Don't worry about where it's going to run. Now, Once you code this, basically you go back here in the Wayang's code snippet, and we will see. Basically, in the first part, in the first four lines, we are declaring the filter that we do on the panels, in the solar panels. In the next block of code, and that is the water filter, is basically on the climate sensors. Then we will perform the join, the group byte, and create the time series using a customized operator in Wayang. As we said, you can extend Wayang with your own operators. So you, in this case, is time series. That is why it's in green in this case. And after you do that, you want to train the model every 6 hours. In this particular case, that is a real application that InfiniMesh created here in Germany. They find out that the model, it was getting very bad after 6 hours. So they have to retrain it. And that is how you do it. You do it there using Wayang. And then you do the prediction that now the code, we don't see it because goes down, but basically you will just use another customized operator where you should predict. And what this customized operator will do, it will just call your model, as simple as that. And that model can be in PyTorch or can be in Keras or another ML system, for example. So what I want you to pay attention here is that if you look at the code, you don't see a single line where you see either Flink or Spark, or not even if it's Cloud, Fog, Edge, or something. It's just focus on the logic of your application, and Wayang will do the rest. How is it going to work? So here is the classical three-layer, architecture of IoT, where you have the Edge, right? That is the main devices, sensors, antennas, radio antennas, and et cetera, right? And then all these sensors, all these devices, edge devices, send data to what we call the fog. And there you will do some processing, if possible. And then you will send aggregate data or pre-processed data to the cloud, where finally you will do some global consensus or global analytics of all this data. And you cannot send the entire edge data to the cloud because it's going to be a bottleneck, right? So think about super peers networks, if you are familiar with that, where you have a master of few slaves and another master of few masters. So that is called super peers. That is what fog cloud are, right? And here on the edge, what Wayang will figure out that in the fog, here we label it fog energy 1 and 2 because it's like a 2 clusters. But we'll figure out that it's better to push down the filter there, close to the edge, right? It will perform it there. And we assume here in this example, think about the way we did it. We have in the fog a Flink that is processing this incoming stream or the stream data streaming coming from the edge devices. And we push down that to Flink. How Wayang can do it? If Wayang doesn't understand about edge, fog, or cloud, is completely transparent for Wayang. It's just because Flink on the fog will have certain capacities than having that on the cloud, because in the fog you will have a powerful machine, for example, or the number of machines is not that large as what you can get on the cloud. So by just that, the cost of performing the filter here or the cloud and moving the data to the cloud, there it will be a trade-off that Wayang will say, let's move that to Flink. Wherever Flink is, in this case, fog is on the fog, sorry. And the same on the cloud, that think about you're running Spark to do the prediction, which kind of like an ML. And there, Wayang will identify, first of all, that the join has to be there. Because if you see, the data comes from multiple edge devices and multiple fog environments. So we need to send it to some kind of like a centralized place, centralized conceptually, because it's still on the cloud, is distributed. So to join the data there, and Wayang will identify that and will say, hey, I need to do it here because moving data from one fog to another is very expensive. So we do it on the cloud. So again, it's not that we do it on the cloud, we do it on a Spark that it turns to be on the cloud. That is basically what Wayang will do. And that is basically how the plan will look like in Wayang and how it's being deployed. And all this completely transparent from the users. And the beauty again here is that then you can bring all the big data technology into the IoT. You don't have to come up with very crazy systems, although you need a system for IoT. And in fact, in TU Berlin, we are building the next generation of a system that is called Nebula Stream, that is a proper system native for IoT. Wayang is not a competitor of this. It's just an alternative. In case you don't have such a native system, this is how you could perform IoT data. So this is one just example of that. So with that, we show more or less how it was looking when we run this. So here on the edge data, we have basically Grafana, and we see that indeed we are receiving data from the sensors and we're putting it into a Kafka server. And there, this Kafka server, it will feed the data into Flink. And we can see on Flink that besides the filter, is doing also some preparation tasks, some pre-processing tasks, and is doing that automatically and sending that to Spark. That is the next step. Again, Flink doesn't send, Flink doesn't know. It's Wayang that connects these two systems and Spark. We see that it starts to process the batches to do the prediction and the ML training every 6 hours. And at the end of the day, Scalytics, that is another company that, as I mentioned, is a company behind, one of the main companies behind also Apache Wayang, Scalytics developed a dashboard that shows to the end user how the prediction looks like compared to the real values. And we can see here, we cannot see it very carefully, but the green one is basically the predicted, and the black one is the real one. And we see they follow pretty much the same. And all this is basically coming from IoT devices. That is how Wayang could enable all this. So with that, let me close this talk by telling you what is the major efforts we're working on right now in Apache Wayang. So first of all, we're trying to support more big data systems. Currently, we support Spark, Apache Flink, Apache Giraffe, GraphKai, Postgres, SQLite, and basically we have a JDBC template to support any other DBMS that supports JDBC, and a Java engine that is us who implement this. Think about an engine for data flows in a standalone Java, single node, everything in main memory. And we want to support machine learning systems, and currently we are trying to do that by supporting the Python API. That is basically another major effort we are doing, that we want to expose more APIs to the developer. Currently, we expose Scala and Java, but we are also already working on the Python API and the SQL API, so that people can send us SQL queries or Python jobs, especially from data science. And then by supporting this Python API, we will be able to plug systems such as PyTorch or even TensorFlow. That is what we want. And the next release is going to be done in the next couple of days. And we are really heavily looking for new contributors that get excited of this, like orchestrating the big data zoo. So please don't hesitate to drop us an email. We're very open to see and discuss new features that may enrich Wayang. For example, in TU Berlin, that is one of the main contributors, they are working on the Wayang debug. So how to debug data flow systems. So they are working on that. Sorry for that. So yes, they are working on coming up with a simple way for debugging data flow systems that today we are lacking, especially in Wayang, that we are working with multiple data flow systems now, or big data systems, how we debug an entire plan. So that was proposed by the TU Berlin guys. So we are open to suggestions for that. And if you want to join, similar to any other Apache project, So you can subscribe to the dev list that is at wayang.apache.org, of course, by sending subscribe to that Wayang list. You find all the information about the community in our webpage, that is wayang.apache.org. And you have there information about the Jira, how to create new issues, and so on, and the repositories as well. So now, as I have mentioned, the main contributors comes mainly from Bifold, TU Berlin, and Escalytics. There are more contributors of this, but we are basically trying to extend this and get some community that can help us to solve these challenging problems that is still Wayang is facing. So with that, I will close the talk, and I would like to discuss or answer questions, please. So I'm going back to the, yes. So I don't stop sharing because maybe I need to go to the slides to answer questions. So yes, do you have any question about how Wayang works or our current efforts, please? Thank you very much for the motivating comments. Yes. Okay. Christian Farf has a question in terms of how we compute the cost of what we call execution operators. This is the Spark operators, Flink operators, Postgres operators, and so on. And it's a very good question. I didn't touch this part on this talk. Yet again, it's an open research problem, by the way. So what we do currently is we do it via profiling. So our cost model is ML-based. So the first thing we do, we go and profile Spark, Flink, and so on. And we do it in an efficient way by running multiple jobs and do some kind of like extrapolation to figure out what is going to be the cost for bigger data sets or more diverse data sets and so on. And once we have execution logs, we learn what is going to be the cost model. So that is the way we learn all this. So that means today we support the Spark or Flink. If you download this to your own cluster, you will have to run what in Wayang have the Wayang profiler. You will have to run a bunch of jobs in your cluster using, if you have Apache Flink, for example, you will run it there, produce a lot of execution logs, and then get to learn what is the cost of the Flink operators or execution operators in your cluster. And then you specify that to Wayang, and every execution operator will come what we call a cost function. That is nothing else like the cost model, the cost formula, considering memory and so on. And this is the output of the profiler, of this learner. It will tell you this is your function that you need to use. So that's basically how we do it. But it's, to be honest, it's very complicated. And we are working as well in the research part on how to replace entirely the cost-based optimizer by an ML-based optimizer. We already have some results and we have a couple of papers on that, but we need to bring it that to the community. That is one of the efforts that we will open as soon as we close the current ones. Okay, another question. I would like to know if I can start my experience with Wayang plus Scala and data stream based on MQTT topics with telemetric data. Okay, perfect. So in fact, that is with this MQTT technology, that is the way we run it for this energy prediction application. So you don't need anything special, let's say. What you need is to have the big data systems where you will really process the data. Remember that Wayang doesn't process the data. It pushes down all this either to Flink or Spark. Once you have this, so then you will need like a queuing service or like a Kafka, but can be another RabbitMQ and so on, where basically you will collect all the streaming data and can be consumed by Spark or Flink. And then Wayang already has the plugin for Spark and Flink. And and in case you have a platform that is currently not supported by Wayang, our experience is that you can add a new platform, and for adding a new platform, you don't need to recompile the entire source code. That's also a big advantage. So adding a new platform is a matter of 3 or 4 days to get it up and running. And we already have examples of how to do this, and we have a template that is the JDBC template on how you can add a new platform. And then once you add it, then it's the same magic as before. You need just to profile it to get the cost and give that to Wayang, and then Wayang will use your platform. That's basically how it works. But you don't need any extra, that's the point, any extra stack of what you are using today. The only extra is going to be Wayang. That's all. Thank you for the questions. You have... another question, Marcin is saying, great, the cost profiler is a special procedure or it's on fly. Could you please detail a bit more what you mean with on fly? That if we run it on the fly, that's your question, Marcin? Okay, while he confirms, let me take the assumption that yes, that if it's on the fly. No, this profiling is not on the fly. And on the fly meaning that when you run a query, you at that moment, you do the profiling. No, you do it offline. And normally we assume that per cluster configuration, you will do it only once. So you have, think about, you have your cluster of 50 nodes with a Spark, Flink, GraphKai, or Apache Giraffe. You will profile all this once. Once you do it, then it's over. You have to redo it only when your cluster change, the characteristics change. That's it. And what happens on the fly, by the way, to predict what is going to be the cardinality of the operators, we do a sample of the data. We do a fast running of your job on that sampling data that takes less than a second. And we get their cardinalities. And we estimate the cardinalities to know what is going to be the cost. That's what we do on the fly. But the profiling, no, we don't do it. It's offline. Yes. Any other question? And again, thank you very much for all these motivating comments. That I'm sure because we have here our Wayang team, so they will be motivated to continue working hard on this as well. So, no more questions. So also, you can send your questions offline, of course, to the dev list. There you can contact us. And yes, so thank you very much, everyone, for attending the talk. I hope that you have learned something about our project and that we could spark some interest in you, and why not either use or joining us on this quest for getting, let's say, orchestrator of these big data animals. Okay. Thank you very much. And see you soon. Bye-bye.